Good morning, dear students. We are going to discuss gluteal region today. So the gluteal region, as you can see here in the picture, we are going to see the structures, like we are going to do the dissection when you come to the dissection hall. So usually we need to reflect the skin like superiorly and inferiorly, and we should also give one like plus mark like incision to reflect the skin of each side of the buttock into four flaps. Once you reflect the skin, or we can also give an incision along the midline and turn the skin as a single flap laterally. Once you reflect the skin, what you will see is we will come across many structures in the gluteal region or the buttock region. So we will be seeing the muscles of the gluteal region, which are actually many in number. We will discuss them one by one. Not only that, we will also come across certain vessels, blood vessels, and also certain important nerves. So we are going to just enlighten our knowledge on these things in the gluteal region. Now, the gluteal region is the region which you see behind you. You can see this is the pelvis, which is shown as an outline. So behind the pelvis, extending from the iliac crest superiorly to the gluteal fold inferiorly, this whole region is considered as gluteal region of each side. Okay, so gluteal fold is this one where I'm showing you the arrow, and it is labeled also here. It's a transverse skin crease for the hip joint and doesn't correspond to the lower border of gluteus maximus. A deep midline groove, this where I'm scrolling my arrow now. So this deep midline groove, that is nothing but the intergluteal cleft, also called as the natal cleft, separates two buttocks from each other. Okay, then. Now, medially, you can see it is extending up to mid dorsal line like this, and the natal cleft, the gluteal region. This one is the medial extent. Laterally is this extent of the gluteal region, which is nothing but an imaginary line, which is joining the anterior superior iliac spine to the anterior edge of this greater trochanter. So this is medial boundary. This is lateral boundary. Okay. So now always I tell you, once we reflect the skin, underlying the skin, there will be a lot of fat in the gluteal region. I will also show you a very short video after the theory lecture so that you will correlate the things what we see in the gluteal region. So below the skin, as you have seen in other regions, we will have superficial fascia. In this region, it will be quite thick, dense, and of course, very well developed. And it is laden with large quantities of fat, especially in women. So that gives a characteristic convexity to the gluteal region, the fat. It forms a thick cushion over the ischial tuberosity. Okay. Now the cutaneous nerve supply, basically the gluteal region will be divided into four quadrants by two lines like this in the form of plus symbol. So we divide it into upper anterior quadrant, lower anterior quadrant, upper posterior quadrant, and lower posterior quadrant. So these quadrants are supplied by the branches of the lumbar and sacral plexuses. Now let us see the upper anterior quadrant. It is supplied by lateral cutaneous branch of subcostal nerve, lateral cutaneous branch of iliohypogastric. Lower anterior quadrant, it is supplied by posterior division of lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh, and the upper posterior quadrant, this one, we have the dorsal rami of L1, L2, L3 and dorsal rami of S1, S2 and S3. Then coming to lower posterior quadrant, we have perforating cutaneous nerve and posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Okay, then. Now, once you start reflecting, you will see the skin and lot of fat is there in the gluteal region. So this gluteal region, I will show you, it is being supplied by superior and inferior gluteal arteries. Okay. And the gluteal region will be draining into lateral group of superficial inguinal lymph nodes. This area, inguinal lymph nodes, I remember I told you when we were discussing front of the thigh, right? Yes. Okay. Then coming to deep fascia, once you reflect the skin, lot of fat is there. Once you clear the fat, you will see a thin fascia covering all the muscles of the gluteal region. That is nothing but the deep fascia. So it is the continuation of fascia lata, what we have seen in the thigh region. So superiorly, it is attached to the iliac crest, okay? And above, and it is behind, back, it is attached to the sacrum. So this like deep fascia is actually splitting to enclose like two muscles. What are those? One is tensor fascia lata. This I told you, we will be also discussing this in gluteal region when we were doing the front of the thigh, if you remember. So the same muscle you are finding here, actually the deep fascia is splitting to enclose these two muscles, which are actually inserted in the iliotibial tract. You can remember in that way. So this deep fascia is splitting to enclose tensor fascia lata and gluteus maximus. Okay, so the one which is splitting to enclose gluteus maximus, it is forming gluteal aponeurosis, which is actually intervening between the gluteus maximus and underlying gluteus medius. Okay, then laterally the fascia is merging with iliotibial tract. Okay, which is nothing but the thickening of the fascia lata, which we have seen on the lateral aspect of the thigh region. Now, the gluteal region, if you observe, we have bones. So you can see the hip bone, you can see the sacrum, you can see the femur, upper end. We also see certain ligaments like sacrospinous ligament and sacrotuberous ligament. From the sacrum to the spine, ischial spine, we have the sacrospinous ligament. From the sacrum to the ischial tuberosity, we have sacrotuberous ligament. Like that, they are named. Above the sacrospinous ligament, whatever hole is there, that is the greater sciatic foramen. Below the sacrospinous ligament, whatever hole is there, that is lesser sciatic foramen. Again, if you remember, when I was discussing hip bone, I told you about these two foramina. Right, that is the greater sciatic foramen and lesser sciatic foramen. Okay, then. So now let us enlighten our knowledge on each. The bones of the gluteal region, what do we see? We see the hip bone, we see the femur, we see articulation of these two bones forming hip joint. Then what are the various ligaments? You see this whole thing is pelvis, where you are finding posteriorly sacrum. This is ilium. We have pubic symphysis of right and left pubic bones, and these are the two ischial tuberosities, right? Then, so just now I told you, extending from the sacrum to the ischial spine, which is shown here in the, like this color, like white color, are corresponding here in the green color. Whatever we have is the sacrospinous ligament, okay? That is extending from the sacrum to the ischial spine. Okay. Whereas if you see from behind, sacrotuberous ligament is like very well appreciated. Again, it is moving from the sacrum to the ischial tuberosity, the one which is shown in orange color. So they convert the greater sciatic foramen, the greater sciatic notch and lesser sciatic notch into greater and lesser sciatic foraminae. The main function of these two ligaments, very, very important function they have, they give stability to the sacrum, okay? Then, they also prevent its posterior rotation at the sacroiliac joint. So this is the hip bone or pelvic cavity, what you see from the anterior aspect, okay? And this is from the posterior aspect. Now, this picture is also taken from the posterior aspect. Where you are seeing the sacrum, hip bone, ischial tuberosity, and the ligaments, the sacrospinous, till the spine of the ischium. You are finding sacrospinous ligament. From the sacrum to the ischial tuberosity, you are calling it as sacrotuberous. So above sacrospinous ligament, the greater sciatic notch is now converted to greater sciatic foramen. Below sacrospinous ligament, we have lesser sciatic foramen. Okay, now. The structures passing through the greater sciatic foramen would be like we have superior gluteal vessels and nerves. Again, I'm going to list out, nothing to worry. So Then muscles arranged are in three layers. I'll show you each and everything. So first layer what we have is gluteus maximus and tensor fascia lata. And in intermediate layer, we have gluteus medius, piriformis, obturator internus with two gamelli, quadratus femoris, adductor magnus, and origin of hamstrings. Okay. Deep layer, we have gluteus minimus, reflected head of rectus femoris, and obturator externus insertion. Now see here, the first muscle what we have is the gluteus maximus. The gluteus maximus has been cut. Or else, I'll show you one more picture. See, the gluteus maximus completely covers like this. We need to cut it along its point of origin from its medial aspect so as to reflect it and see what are the structures which are lying below it. That's how the gluteus maximus has been cut and reflected. Once you cut the gluteus maximus, you will see the gluteus medius underneath the gluteus maximus. Underneath the gluteus medius, we will see gluteus minimus. Okay, just below the minimus, we will see the key muscle of gluteal region, which is called as piriformis. It is so called as key muscle because just below piriformis, we will see sciatic nerve coming. I'll show you in my upcoming slides. As you go down, you are finding there is one tendon that is actually the tendon of obturator internus, above which you have one muscle, below which you have one muscle. The above muscle is named as superior gamellus. Below muscle is named as inferior gamellus. As you go down, lower down, you are finding quadratus femoris. So these are the muscles what we see in the gluteal region. Like any other region, again, we should know the origin, insertion, nerve supply, and action of all these muscles, right? Now, the gluteus maximus, if you observe, so it is, from where is it taking its origin? You are finding it is coming from the sacrum bone. If you remember the gluteal surface of the hip bone, I talked about the posterior gluteal line. Behind the posterior gluteal line also it takes its origin, isn't it? From the sacrotuberous ligament also it takes its origin. So like that, so this is the hip bone, just as a revision, you have, this is the greater sciatic notch, this is the lesser sciatic notch, this is the ischial spine where the sacrospinous ligament comes and attaches. Above this, you will see the conversion into greater sciatic foramen. Below this, you will see the conversion into lesser sciatic foramen. Okay, then see, if you observe this picture, behind the posterior gluteal line, the one which is shown in this dotted area, this is giving origin to gluteus maximus. Okay, and insertion, if you remember, I told you gluteal tuberosity, okay, which is seen in the femur bone. So insertion goes to gluteal tuberosity. Now see here, this is the iliotibial tract that shows this picture has been taken from the lateral side. So then you will see the two muscles are taking its insertion. One is the gluteus maximus and tensor fascia lata. Once you cut the gluteus maximus, underlying we have the gluteus medius. As we go down, we have minimus and many other muscles. Now, after seeing diagrammatically, let us see like in detail the origin of each. So gluteus maximus is the largest and most superficial muscle. That means as soon as you cut the skin, immediately below the skin, we will see the gluteus maximus. It forms the prominence of the buttock region. Origin is outer surface of the ilium behind the posterior gluteal line. Outer sloping surface, I have shown you this, surface of the iliac crest, posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. This we will see the details of this fascia when we do abdomen. And then gluteal aponeurosis, I told you fascia lata is actually splitting to enclose this gluteus maximus. So this fascia also gives origin to the few fibers of gluteus maximus. Posterior surface of the sacrum and coccyx bone and sacrotuberous ligament. This is our sacrotuberous ligament. So many points of origins it has. Again, if you just look at this picture, like behind the posterior gluteal line, we have this gluteus maximus. Sacrum is taking part. Sacrotuberous ligament is taking part. This picture also helps us to understand the insertion point, this blue line, all of the bony elevated thickening. That is the gluteal tuberosity, which we see in the femur bone. So insertion, see, this is a bulky muscle. So most of the muscle is inserted into the iliotibial tract, as we know, apart from that. So So deeper fibers, that is 1/4 of its deeper fibers, are inserted into gluteal tuberosity. Nerve supply, inferior gluteal nerve. So though this muscle is called as maximus, but remember, nerve supply is inferior gluteal nerve, okay, not superior gluteal nerve. So the root value is L5, S1 and S2. Blood supply, we have superior and inferior gluteal vessels, okay. Then veins form an extensive plexus is beneath the muscle. I'll show you one dissection video. There we can appreciate also so much of blood vessel network will be there. Now coming to the action of this big bulky muscle, that is the gluteus maximus. It is the extensor of hip joint. That's how it helps in running and climbing upstairs. Lateral rotator of the hip joint. Chief anti-gravity muscle in act of sitting from standing. Then extends the knee joint also through iliotibial tract. And give simultaneous stability to the hip and knee joints through iliotibial tract. So upper fibers are powerful abductors of hip joint. Okay, you can see the abduction, okay, and the outward rotation of this, the stability of this lower limb is being brought about, the anti-gravity muscle, even in sitting. So this is all brought about by the gluteus maximus. Now once, see, the gluteus maximus has been cut over here. You are not finding gluteus maximus. We are cutting this gluteus maximus to see if there are any bursae. I told you bursae are nothing but the extensions of synovial membrane, which are filled with synovial fluid in order to give lubrication wherever there is more friction, isn't it? So like what are the various bursae based on the place where they are present? We have gluteofemoral bursa. Okay, so lies between the gluteus maximus and tendon of vastus lateralis. Then we have trochanteric bursa. So lies between gluteus maximus tendon and greater trochanter, as you can see here. Then we have ischial bursa, lies between gluteus maximus and ischial tuberosity. This is for lubrication. Then this is a very important question. We have structures under the cover of gluteus maximus is very important. We have also seen structures of gluteus maximus under the cover like deltoid when we were doing upper limb. I told you there also it is equally important. Here also it is usually 5 marks question. Okay. So the structures under the cover of gluteus maximus, we have bones and ligaments like ilium, ischial tuberosity, sacrum, coccyx, greater trochanter, sacrotuberous ligament, dorsal, sacroiliac ligaments. Everything I have shown you in the form of diagram also. So underneath the gluteus maximus, we have seen gluteus medius, piriformis, tricipital tendon, that is nothing but superior gamellus, obturator internus and inferior gamellus. We have quadratus femoris. As you come much lower down, we have hamstring muscles, which are nothing but the muscles of the posterior compartment of the thigh. The vessels and nerves we see, I'll show you now, that is structures passing through the greater sciatic notch. That means we will see the superior and inferior gluteal vessels and nerves. Just now we saw the three bursae, gluteofemoral bursa, trochanteric bursa and ischial bursa. We will also come across two arterial networks, that is anastomosis, one at the level of trochanter and the next anastomosis is called as cruciate anastomosis. We will see the details of this also. Now let us see. This is our gluteus maximus muscle. Okay, this is the midline and this is the lateral aspect. You are finding the iliotibial tract, this side. That also will help you to identify to which side it belongs to. So this is the gluteus maximus muscle. You gave an incision along its midline. Once you reflect this muscle, you see you are finding gluteus medius. Below gluteus medius, we have gluteus minimus. Below this, we have key muscle, that is piriformis. Below piriformis, we have tricipital tendon, that is nothing but the obturator internus, above which we have superior gamellus, below which we have inferior gamellus. This is quadratus femoris. As you come down, lower down, these are all hamstring muscles. Hamstring muscles are nothing but the muscles of the posterior compartment of the thigh. So below piriformis, the name of this nerve is sciatic nerve. Because sciatic nerve is coming just below the piriformis is generally considered as key muscle of gluteal region. Okay, so this is the superficial dissection. Once you cut this muscle, you will see the underlying muscle. This is not with any labeling. just pause the video. First, learn the names from this slide and try to label it without seeing, so that it helps you to become perfect this region. Okay, so all are labeled now. Gluteus maximus is cut. We have below maximus, we have medius, then minimus, then piriformis, then superior gamellus, obturator internus, inferior gamellus, then quadratus femoris. Okay, then this is what gluteal tuberosity, where you see the insertion of gluteus maximus. Then now see here, basically the gluteal region, we are now dividing it into four quadrants, right? So why are we dividing it into four quadrants? For our convenience, whenever you are planning to give any intramuscular injection, always you see that you give it in the superolateral compartment, because the superolateral compartment is comparatively safe zone. As you come down here, we will see the piriformis, below which you will see sciatic nerve is passing. So if you choose any other compartment other than this, there may be more or less risk of damaging the sciatic nerve. So as to avoid this, generally we give intramuscular injections in upper and outer quadrant. Okay, then so, and gluteus maximus is quite bulky muscle, hence it absorbs large amount of drug, and it has lot of blood vessel network also, I said just below. So that's how easily it is absorbed into the blood circulation. Okay, then so the injection site must be carefully selected to avoid injury to the underlying large vessels and nerves. Then again, you are finding maximus muscle, gluteus maximus, below which we have medius, below medius we have minimus. This is obturator foramen, from where you are finding obturator internus, and this is tendon of obturator internus, above which you will have superior gamellus and inferior gamellus. Okay, then gluteus medius. Now this second muscle also, we should know the origin, insertion, nerve supply action. So origin, outer surface of the ileum. Just if you are thorough with hip bone osteology and the osteology of femur, you will write in your own words, and this will be only a recollection of what we have already learned in osteology. So medius is coming from the outer surface of the ileum, between the anterior and posterior gluteal lines, also from gluteal aponeurosis. Insertion, lateral surface of the greater trochanter along the oblique ridge. Okay, that is greater trochanter. Nerve supply, this is superior gluteal nerve, whereas gluteus maximus was inferior gluteal nerve. Remember this. Okay, root value of superior gluteal nerve is L4, L5 and S1. Action, it is also abducting and medially rotating the thigh and steadying the pelvis in walking. Okay, so this is medius muscle. If you cut medius, it's coming from the gluteal surface of the hip bone. Okay, this was the posterior gluteal line. This was the anterior gluteal line, below which we had the inferior gluteal line, right? So now see, this is gluteus minimus. Between these gluteal lines only we will see the origin of these muscles. Okay, then so this is the greater trochanter, which you see from the superior view. This helps us to remember the insertions very easily. On the medial aspect of the greater trochanter, we will see the insertion of this tricipital tendon, that is obturator internus with superior and inferior gamellus. Okay, below which you will see the insertion of piriformis. Then we are seeing greater trochanter is also associated with the insertion of gluteus minimus and gluteus medius. Between them we are finding bursae. Minimus, gluteus minimus, origin, outer surface of ileum, between anterior and inferior gluteal lines. Okay, so once you lift the medius, you will see the minimus. Insertion is anterior surface of the greater trochanter. Nerve supply is again superior gluteal nerve, same like gluteus medius. Action, abducts and medially rotates the thigh. Okay, then so there is one important topic which you need to understand, which is called as Trendelenburg sign. So acting from below, see, this is the normal posture which you see from behind when a person is walking. Okay, gait is G-A-I-T. Gait is nothing but manner of walking. Okay, so when you see Trendelenburg acting from below, both the gluteus medius and minimus prevent the unsupported side. Suppose if we are walking, this is the unsupported side of the leg. So it is actually being supported by gluteus medius and minimus. Hence, the horizontal level of pelvis is being maintained by opposite gluteus medius and minimus. Okay. In case if there is any fracture, if the greater trochanter or the neck of the femur, or if there is any paralysis of this superior gluteal nerves, you will see medius and minimus are paralyzed. So what happens is, see, when the gluteus medius and minimus are paralyzed due to injury of the superior gluteal nerve, the pelvis sags on the healthy side. Here is the healthy side. The healthy side's upward movement was actually supported by medius and minimus of opposite side. Because these muscles are now paralyzed, the upward gait is not being maintained. Okay, the pelvis sags on the healthy side. Pause this video, read this slide 2 to 3 times and try to understand, because Trendenberg sign is very, very important. Till you go to your final year in orthopedics also, you will come across this. Okay, so the pelvis is sagging on the health. Sagging means it is drooping downwards, because normally the upward movement is being maintained by gluteus medius and minimus. Okay, as a result, the person walks with a lurching gait. So this is clinically known as positive Trendelenburg sign. Okay, then what are the various reasons? Why is it drooping downwards? It may be like fracture of the neck of the femur, dislocation of hip joint, okay, more angulation, that is coxa vara, non-functioning gluteus medius and minimus due to neurological damage, that is compression of this superior gluteal nerve, because L4, L5 disc, like intervertebral disc herniation, or any disease affecting exclusively muscles called as myopathy. So all these underlying causes are responsible for positive Trendelenburg sign, where you will see the healthy side of the leg is drooping downwards. The pelvis is sagging on healthy side due to failure of opposite gluteus medius and minimus to maintain it in normal horizontal position. Okay. The next muscle we are coming now is tensor fasciae latae. Origin is the outer lip of the iliac crest between the anterior superior iliac spine and iliac tubercle. Insertion is into the iliotibial tract. Nerve supplies, again same superior gluteal nerve. Action, it abducts the hip joint through iliotibial tract and maintains knee in extended position. Okay, if you remember this picture, what I have used while teaching you the hip bone, we have seen this is the anterior superior iliac spine, posterior superior iliac spine, and here in the outer lip, we have tensor fasciae latae, origin. Next, our key muscle, that is piriformis, origin, anterior surface of the sacrum by 3 digitations from the bar of bones. I'll show you in the next slide, between anterior sacral foraminae and area lateral to foramina. Or you see this, this one is the piriformis. This is the sacrum bone, these are the sacral foraminae. So 1, 2, 3, 4 sacral foraminae. In between these sacral foraminae, you are finding the origin of piriformis. 3 digitations from the bar of bones between the anterior sacral foraminae or area lateral to the foraminae. Okay, and also you will see it is taking its origin from the outer surface here of the ilium close to posterior inferior iliac spine. This is posterior superior and this is posterior inferior iliac spine in vicinity, that is close by. Capsule of the sacroiliac joint, sacrotuberous ligament, what we have seen, upper margin of the greater sciatic notch. This is the greater sciatic notch. Okay, then. So this is the origin of piriformis. Okay, then. Piriformis is getting inserted. You can see this is the trochanteric fossa anteriorly. Insertion, this is the upper border of the greater trochanter, nerve supply, anterior rami of S1 and S2. Action, it is the lateral rotator of the thigh. And it helps in assisting the and also stabilizing the hip joint, especially in abduction. Then piriformis syndrome, what is this? Characterized by pain in buttock due to the compression of sciatic nerve. I have been telling you, piriformis is the key muscle, because just below piriformis, sciatic nerve is coming out. In case, if there is compression of the sciatic nerve due to some inflammation of piriformis, then usually there may be pain in the buttock region. Usually we see such symptoms in sportspersons that where they use more of these gluteal muscles like ice skaters, cyclists, etc., which causes hypertrophy or spasm of piriformis. Then this is sciatic nerve. So generally when we are doing certain procedures of the gluteal region or the posterior compartment of the thigh, we generally block this nerve. Okay, that is what is called a sciatic nerve block, so that there is no sensation while the surgeon is performing any surgery. So injecting an anesthetic agent a few centimeters below the midpoint of the line joining this one, the posterior superior iliac spine and the upper border of the greater trochanter, like this. Okay, and if you just join one more line to the sacral hiatus, if you just join like this, the midpoint to the sciatic nerve. So this is the point where we usually choose for injections, the anesthetic drug. Okay, there are certain variations. Basically, piriformis, I told you, is the key muscle below which the sciatic nerve is coming. Sometimes sciatic nerve may pierce the piriformis. Sometimes the sciatic nerve may come above the piriformis muscle also. Okay, in such conditions, it may be compressed, leading to pain in buttock region, which is called as piriformis syndrome. Just now I told you, we find in sportsperson, ice skater, cyclist, etc. Next muscle we come across is obturator internus. Origin, inner surface of the obturator membrane and adjacent bone, that is the ischiopubic ramus and body of ischium. Then insertion, the upper border of the greater trochanter along with the superior gamellus and inferior gamellus. Nerve supply, nerve to obturator internus and lateral rotator. It's the lateral rotator of hip joint. Now coming to superior and inferior gamellae, see origin of the superior gamellus. See, this one is the superior gamellus. It is coming from the ischial spine and inferior gamellus is coming from ischial tuberosity. Insertion is the upper border of the greater trochanter. Nerve supply, superior is receiving nerve supply from the nerve to obturator internus and inferior gamellus is receiving nerve supply from nerve to quadratus femoris, which is just lying below the inferior gamellus. Okay, this is also lateral rotator of thigh. And then last muscle we have, that is quadratus femoris, origin lateral border of the ischial tuberosity. You can see this insertion is quadrate tubercle of the femur. Nerve supply, nerve to quadratus femoris, and action is, again, this is also lateral rotator of thigh. Okay, this is the quadrate tubercle where you will see between the greater and lesser trochanter, this point you have is the quadrate tubercle when you see from behind. Okay, that is, this is the gluteal tuberosity where you see the insertion of gluteus maximus along with iliotibial tract. Now let us see just this posterior view I kept so that want to emphasize the fact of this greater and lesser sciatic foraminae. The notch has been converted into foramen. The first ligament we have is the sacrospinous ligament. The second ligament we have is the sacrotuberous ligament. This is sacrospinous and this is sacrotuberous. The above foramen is greater sciatic foramen. This one is also greater sciatic. Below foramen is lesser sciatic foramen. This one is also lesser sciatic foramen. Now, what are the various structures we see passing through the greater sciatic foramen? You will see piriformis, which is the key muscle. So here in the greater sciatic foramen, you see the like sciatic nerve. These vessels are inferior gluteal vessels and nerves. And you see superior gluteal vessels and nerves. Then posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, this one. The one which is accompanying the thickest nerve of our body. Medially, there is one more thin nerve, no? That is nothing but posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. So these are the structures which pass through the greater sciatic foramen. This may be asked for 3 marks. Okay, similarly, we have structures passing through lesser sciatic foramen. So we have obturator internus tendon with 2 gamellae, that is superior and inferior gamellus. This is our tendon. Okay, you call it as even like triceps coxae also we can call it as a tricipital tendon, I told you previously. So we have pin structures passing So what are the pin structures we have from the lesser sciatic foramen? They will be actually entering into the pudendal region, external genitalia region. So what are these? The first yellow in color is pudendal nerve. We have internal pudendal vessels and nerve to obturator internus. Okay. So they are generally remembered like pin structures. Very, very important viva question also it is, what are the structures passing through inferior sciatic foramen? So inferior sciatic foramen, we have this pin structures. P is standing for pudendal nerve. I is inferior pudendal vessels and N is nerve to obturator internus. Okay. So these cross the ischial spine, as you can see here, from the greater foramen to the lesser. That means from the greater sciatic foramen, now they are entering into lesser sciatic foramen. Okay. So pudendal nerve, this is very, very important nerve, which is, I told you, it is reaching the pudendal, the external genitalia region, which it can be blocked by local anesthetic drug at ischial spine. This is the point of ischial spine, right? So why do we block it? Suppose if there is during the process of labor, if labor pains are too much, and if you are planning to do a surgical procedure to widen the vulval outlet to deliver the head of the baby, there will be a technique called as episiotomy. Okay, for that purpose, this we will elaborate again when we are doing abdomen region. Nothing to worry, I'm just introducing the word. Okay, so this is the external genitalia region. Pudendal nerve can be blocked by injecting the lignocaine type of drug, xylocaine type of anesthetic drug here in the pudendal region, in the pudendal nerve, so that we can perform the surgical procedures in the vulva region, okay, the external genitalia female, okay. So the widening of this vulval outlet is nothing but episiotomy. In order to do episiotomy, we generally do pudendal nerve block. This I will elaborate when we are doing the abdomen region, pelvis, okay. So bilaterally, you do the pudendal nerve block. So the nerves of gluteal region, to summarize, above we have the superior gluteal vessels and nerves, below we have inferior gluteal vessels and nerves, right? This is the sciatic nerve, this is the posterior femoral cutaneous nerve. We have seen pin structures there, we have seen pudendal nerve and nerve to obturator internus. Okay, that is. Now, arteries of gluteal region, if you observe the previous picture also, along with nerves, we also have arteries. Suppose this is superior gluteal vessels, we have superior gluteal nerve. Inferior gluteal vessels, we have inferior gluteal nerve. Okay. So, arteries in the gluteal region, we come across branches of internal iliac artery. Those are superior and inferior gluteal vessels. Branches of femoral artery also come here. We have lateral circumflex femoral and medial circumflex femoral arteries we see here. Then branches of profunda femoris artery, that is the first perforating branch, is visible here in the gluteal region. Okay, the superior gluteal arteries above piriformis, inferior gluteal arteries below piriformis. These are the branches of internal iliac artery. Okay, they supply the gluteal region. Then trochanteric anastomosis. This can be a 3 marks question. That means at the greater trochanter, we will see the few blood vessels which are seen in the gluteal region, they form a network of, that is nothing but anastomosis. So this is the main supply of the head and neck of the femur. It provides a connection between internal iliac and femoral arteries. It lies in the trochanteric fossa. Okay, branches run along the femoral neck beneath the retinacular fibers of the capsule of the hip joint. Is formed by descending branches of the superior and inferior gluteal vessels and ascending branches of lateral and medial circumflex femoral artery. These 2 points you need to remember. See the names of the blood vessels which form trochanteric anastomosis. Okay, descending branches of superior and inferior gluteal vessels and ascending branches of lateral and medial circumflex femoral arteries. Okay, that is. And then you have cruciate anastomosis also, which we see at the back of the thigh, okay, at the level of lesser trochanter. So it provides a connection again between the internal iliac and femoral arteries. So what are the various vessels which take part in cruciate anastomosis? descending branch of inferior gluteal artery, transverse branches of medial and lateral circumflex femoral artery, and ascending branch of first perforating artery. So this point we have cruciate. Cruciate is nothing but cross, what we see in church. Okay, that cross, Christian's church. Okay, that is the meaning of cruciate anastomosis. Please remember these three blood vessels. Okay, the dangerous quadrant, I already told you, we should be very careful not to damage hiatic nerve when you are planning to give intramuscular injection. It is always wise to choose the upper outer quadrant. Okay, the safe quadrant in the gluteal upper lateral quadrant or outer quadrant. Okay, this I have already discussed the importance. Then, so we have seen medius and minimus. This is the sciatic nerve. This will be discussed in detail when we do the sacral plexus. Nothing to worry. In case of piriformis syndrome, this may get compressed and there may be pain along the distribution of the nerve. That is called a sciatica. Okay, the pain is radiating from the buttocks down the leg and can travel as far as feet and toes. Okay, then. So there are two important lines also which we come across in the gluteal region called as Nelaton's line and Bryant's triangle, which are actually important orthopedically. Just as a clinical point, we will try to understand. I'm trying to show you the picture and then understand, make you understand. We have, see, this is the Nelaton's line. So which is a line drawn from, see, anterior superior iliac spine to the most prominent part of the ischial tuberosity. Okay, it crosses the center of the acetabulum and the upper border of the greater trochanter. This is Nelaton's line. So this line should be constant and it has to be in this level. Only if the person's bones are normal and if there are no fractures, you will see this line is in straight line. Otherwise, if the Nelaton's line is disturbed, there may be some underlying pathology. Can be fracture or dislocation or something like that. Then there is one more triangle which is actually formed by joining two lines which is called as Bryant's triangle. This is a right angle triangle which is again formed, suppose this is the anterior superior iliac spine. From here you need to take a line which is joining the greater trochanter, but not in a straight line, but you have to take it as a right angle. Okay, junction of the perpendicular lines from two points. One is from the anterior superior iliac spine, and another one perpendicular line you are drawing from greater trochanter and you are allowing them to meet. So whatever triangle is being formed between the Nelaton's line and these two perpendicular lines, this is what is Bryant's triangle. Again, it has again orthopedic significance. Okay, this is to summarize, we have seen the muscle structures under the cover of gluteus maximus. We have seen vessels and we have also seen nerves, isn't it? So, I will also try to show you one small video. So, you can see this is the dissection of gluteal region. Okay. So, the body is lying in prone position. Okay. So, in this dissection of gluteal region, we are seeing this is the skin flap has been cut superiorly. There is one incision at the gluteal fold. There is one incision and even in the midline, that is the natal cleft, we have one more incision. And now we are going to reflect the skin laterally. So once you reflect the skin laterally, you will see gluteus maximus first. See, as you can see here, the skin is being reflected. So just below the skin, actually we will have lot of fat that will be the superficial fascia. And this muscle, whatever you are seeing, the big bulky muscle is nothing but gluteus maximus. The gluteus maximus is also showing one covering that is nothing but the aponeurosis. Okay, now again, for our convenience, the gluteus maximus also has been cut. And it is now being reflected. Now let us see slowly. Okay, we have seen its origin and insertion and everything. And then, so see, the gluteus maximus is now reflected. So just below the gluteus maximus, we are finding these are the superior and inferior gluteal vessels and nerves. Okay, so this whole thing, what this big bulky muscle is gluteus maximus. Okay, so once you reflect gluteus maximus, so this is inferior gluteal nerve which goes into the maximus, and these are the inferior gluteal vessels. Okay, one is artery and the other is vein. Inferior gluteal artery is white in color, and bluish or blackish in color is vein, inferior gluteal vein. Okay, so this is gluteus maximus. I told you there will be a network right below the gluteus maximus. So once you reflect gluteus maximus, you are able to see the other muscles. So what are the various muscles we have? So we have gluteus medius, and below which we have gluteus minimus. Okay, so that is, so once you reflect maximus, we will see the medius and minimus. Okay, see, this is medius which is now being reflected very clearly. Once you have reflected maximus, we have seen this is medius. Now the medius is also cut and it is being reflected. Okay, and below the medius you are finding there is one more muscle, whitish aponeurotic sheath containing this muscle. Okay, this is of course the superior gluteal vessels now, because this is the key muscle, piriformis. Above piriformis we have superior gluteal vessels and nerves, and the muscle you are finding is gluteus minimus. Okay, so one below the other we found three muscles. First was the maximus, below which we saw the medius, and then we have the minimus. This is piriformis. Okay, so now see here you will see below piriformis. So this is the piriformis muscle. This is the key muscle. How to identify this muscle? Below this you will see the thickest nerve of our body, that is the sciatic nerve. Okay, along the sciatic nerve you are also finding one more thin nerve, that is the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Okay, these are the inferior gluteal vessels and nerves. Okay, inferior gluteal vessels and nerves. You are finding few structures which are actually passing from the greater sciatic foramen. They will be moving into lesser sciatic foramen. Those are nothing but pin structures. If you remember, I told you pudendal nerve and internal iliac artery and nerve to obturator internus, isn't it? So these are the pin structures. Then if you observe this picture, so we know like below piriformis we have the sciatic nerve. So this will be the tricipital tendon. Okay, that means we have the obturator internus tendon, superior gamellus, inferior gamellus. Lower down this will be quadratus femoris. Now see, once you clear the things, you see it much better. You are lifting sciatic nerve so as to see this tricipital tendon. Below tricipital tendon you are finding quadratus femoris. This is quadratus femoris. Okay, the last muscle, and this is the tricipital tendon. So that is what you have. So you can also, we are going to share anyhow YouTube video. Okay, so you can follow that video, or you can watch from this video also. So to summarize what we have seen in the gluteal region, we saw various muscles. First muscle was gluteus maximus. When you cut that, you saw the gluteus medius. Then below that we saw minimus. Piriformis is key muscle, above which you have the superior gluteal vessels and nerves, below which we have inferior gluteal vessels and nerves. Apart from that we have sciatic nerve, posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. We saw the pin structures, isn't it? What are the various structures we saw? The pudendal nerve, internal pudendal artery. Okay, and then we saw nerve to obturator internus. Okay, and as you go down below this quadratus femoris, we will see hamstring muscles. Okay, then that's it. Thank you. Study well. All the best.